The topic that I would like to discuss today is related to the urban energy, the problems that we encounter. In order to discuss this issue, I would first give you the brief definitions of what we understand by the different energy sources and also urbanization that we experience today. Among the different energy sources which are existing starting from the beginning of the human civilization, these are mostly like traditional fuel energies like wood and charcoal. We have fossil fuel energy like natural gas, oil and coal. And then with the development of science, technology and engineering, we have newer and newer energy sources like hydroelectric energy, nuclear energy, then the non-conventional renewable energies like solar energy, wind energy, ocean energy, and also energy that we can derive from biomasses. So, these are the different energy sources on one hand, and the other relevant term to be understood is urbanization. When we talk of organization, urbanization, it does not necessarily represent only the fact that the population density is very thick in that particular area. It is also associated with the process of certain changes in the human behavior. The important influences of urbanization is associated with the rapid migration of population from the rural areas around that particular urban area, and this rural population, which normally comprise with the factors such as the changing approaches, as they get acclimatized more and more with the urban life, that introduces also some newer dimensions in terms of new informations and newer types of infrastructures. With the above introductions to urbanization and energy sources, now I would like to throw some light on the different kinds of available energy sources in the world. And these sources, they would probably help one to understand more clearly the concepts of urban problem related to energy. Many of us may be aware in today's scenario that the major source of energy that we use today is basically from fossil fuels. And these fossil fuels are like natural gas, oil and coal. These sources provided almost about 87% of the total energy that we get today on earth. And to be more specific, these 87% can be divided into the three sectors, like natural gas having 23% contribution, then the fossil oil like petrol, diesel, kerosene, etc. has got 38% contribution, and the fossil solid fuel, which is coal, has a contribution of 26%. The remaining 13% of the energy that we use today are derived mostly from nuclear powers and the hydroelectric power. Each one of them contribute to about 6% of the total energy resources. Then there is another 1% remaining, which is a very recent concept. We use the different kinds of renewable energy sources like solar energy, wind energy, ocean energy, then energy from biomasses, etc. But of course, it is expected that with the growing demand of energy, very soon, maybe around 2025 or 30, a stage will come when we will find that this sector with 1% may rise to about 10%, and the competition with the available other sources would become very much compromising in nature, because these available energy sources, they would also become costlier in the coming years. Once we have definite idea about the available energy today in the world, now we look at the newer dimension known as the growth of urban areas, especially in the developing countries. In around 2010, the world had a total population of about 7 billion, and with the present rate of growth of population, it is expected that by around 2050, the population on this earth would be around 9.2 billion. This additional number, that is 2.2 billion, will be mostly from the developing countries. And more surprising is the fact that this additional population, almost 90% of it, would be contributing to the creation of newer and newer urban areas and the expansion of already existing urban areas in most of the developing countries. Today, if we look at the scenario of urbanization, then we can find that it is mostly Asia, Africa and Latin America. These three continents, they are contributing maximum to the problem of urbanization. So far as the developing countries in the West, like North America, Europe, or even countries like Australia, Japan, Korea, the developments have come more or less to a saturation level. The annual growth rate of industrialization and urbanization cannot be more than 2% in these areas. But on the other hand, in these developing countries, especially like China, India, Brazil, the annual growth rate is around 8.5 to 9.5 per annum, and most of the other developing and underdeveloped countries, this is about 4 to 5%. Now, this growth in population naturally is a matter of concern related to the urbanization, because as I told earlier, that almost 90% of this population would be concentrating in the different urban areas of the three continents of Asia, Africa and Latin America. With such rapid growth, there will be obviously an enormous necessity of additional energy supply, and one has to compromise between the energy supply and the energy demand in these urban areas. The creation of space for accommodating this urban growth is closely related with the different infrastructural developments in those urban sectors. And this obviously means the important parameters like popularly as we call bijli, sarak, pani, this electricity, roads and water. And these are the different problems which one has to solve before a smooth growth of the urban areas can take place. The growth of urban areas, as I mentioned earlier, create the crisis of energy in the world. If we review the existing scenario in terms of the world energy resources, it is expected that we have got about 1100 billion tons of coal equivalent, briefly we call TCE. This 1100 billion TCEs of energy, it comprises of fuel energy, comprises of all other sources of energies, and at the present rate of consumption of energy, the world today consumes about 15 billion tons of coal equivalent. And if we calculate it carefully, we find that by the end of this century, these conventional energy sources would be completely exploited. Obviously, this warrants the creation of newer and newer sources of energy on one hand, and on the other, we must have better planning of the growth of urban areas in the developing countries. To have the world in a more comfortable way in front of the human civilization, we can have different efforts to resolve this energy crisis, and we cannot deny that there will be urban growth in the developing countries. Some of these processes could include the expansion of the R&D activities and the technological exploitation of renewable energy sources for healthy economic growth of a country. If we want to look for these kinds of solutions, then obviously it is the combined responsibility of the different public administration sectors, such as the local governments, the state governments, and the central government in a particular country. And the points which should be specifically addressed to by these three different sections of the public administration are like planning and managing city developments, establishing and enforcing effective building codes and building plans, the basic services such as providing roads, water supply, electricity supply, waste management, street lighting, etc., are to be managed by the local governments in an effective manner, and that should also include the procurement of the raw materials. We should have the full responsibility of the city transportation in the hands of the local government, with contributions coming from state and central governments. The local government should set examples before the city dwellers in the urban areas on the different approaches that could lead to saving of energy. These local governments, they have large number of employees, and at the same time they have got a large number of office buildings in the urban areas. Managing energy, planning buildings, creating green sources, all these things are the responsibility of the local government, and hence I can say that for smoother and long term growth of the urban areas, the local governments should concentrate on the creation of a road map which may be as follows, and we call it popularly as the sustainable energy path for urban areas. The different components of this roadmap should be like reduction of carbon emission, reduction of fossil fuel dependence, introduction of different clean fuels to increase the use of renewable energies, to promote the diversification of the different existing energy sources, to support the local and decentralized power supply to the city dwellers, also to focus on the energy efficiency, to ensure that the citizens' access to the energy services and information are in the best way of energy savings through the energy supplies by the local governments. The roadmap that I mentioned so far can be defined with some more critical points, and these points may be as follows. The local government must ensure appropriate space utilization while planning for urbanization or the growth of the urban areas, then to develop efficient and accessible public transport system, and this public transport must use cleaner fuels. The government should create a sustainable and low carbon energy vision for the future, which is very, very critical in today's context. Also, the critical energy auditing should form an important energy consumption system for the local governments. The government should also have to examine critically how much energy is actually needed and how much energy is actually used, and also to audit the carbon emission, or popularly we call C emission. In order to simplify the energy problems which are there in any urban area in the developing countries, some of the informations which are vital must be available to the different governments at local, state or central level. These informations are the energy demand and energy supply specially. To elaborate the factor energy demand, one requires to have a clear cut information on the energy or power required from the different sectors such as the residential areas, the industry and commerce area and the transportation. Regarding the other sector, that is energy supply, which is more vital, we need to know at length about all the different modes of energy supply in the city or the urban area, such as coal, natural gas, liquid fuels like petrol, diesel, kerosene, etc. Then the electricity component, which may come from nuclear sectors or from thermal electric sector or from hydroelectricity. And once these two parameters, the supply and demand parameters of energy, is processed and dealt with delicately with proper budgeting and auditing, it is anticipated that the urban problem related to energy may be minimized. As in the present talk, I have given you a roadmap starting with the concepts of energy sources and urbanization, the growth of urban areas in the developing countries, the huge growth of population in the developing countries would be mostly concentrated in the different urban areas, and then with the different kinds of well thought plans equally contributed by the governments at different levels. I would like to conclude that it is not necessary that one in a developing country has to follow blindly the path adopted in the West. The geography of the country, the resource potentiality of the country, the urban population growth, all these factors should be taken care of in such a way that a right solution for the right place at the right time can emerge. And this is not possible only by the participation of the governments. It is also the society at length must see to it that they have a responsible role to play, because energy resources are limited, whereas the growth of human civilization is acutely dependent upon the energy supply. And hence, my last statement would be, for happy human civilization, a responsible participation of the civilized people are equally important. Thank you.